Welcome, everybody, to
the Cellcast.
I'm malicious, mean, and scary. My sneer could curdle dairy. And violence-wise, my hands are not the cleanest. But despite my evil look and my temper and my hook, I've always yearned to be a touch of penis. To see me on the stage performing Mozart.
Welcome, everybody, to the second episode of the Cellcast. Let me introduce...
Whoa, wait a minute! Hold on, apparently something went wrong with the last recording, so apparently we have to re-record this.
Yes, because that's nothing any other podcast has ever had to do with
before. No, of course not!
So, we tried to record this episode last week, and we recorded the entire episode, went to check what it sounded like after, because silly me didn't think to actually listen to what was coming out before we started recording. Yeah, there's a rookie mistake, if ever there was one. And it sounded like
our
robots.
Engineers. Yeah.
We're talking into a fan. I couldn't tell which. So.
I started talking into the mic when you were talking.
Okay. That is one of the advantages when we talk over each other. So yeah, we I don't even remember what I was going to say.
Yeah.
Sorry.
That's fine. No, that's fine.
No, we were talking about, you were talking about how...
Yeah, about know, how we were robots. Or how it roboted on us.
You know, so. how this whole thing...
Okay, so I said it, you started right after I said how, if there was ever another rookie mistake.
Yes.
Okay, so. So yeah, we had a couple issues with something I tried and failed with, and I should have listened to it, but you live, you learn, you move on.
Yeah, and you don't get a pins.
I think it's loves. I think that's the phrase. It's not depends, but we're a little old for loves anyway. So
yeah, just a bit.
Just a touch.
I was talking about like old people.
Yeah, but we're starting to ramble a little bit here, but that's fine. I was thinking like the actual slogan was live and learn and then get loves. Not that we are sponsored by either loves or depends.
No, we are not.
Not that we'll turn down free money. Anyway, this is... Let me introduce your host for the evening, Jacob.
Why, thank you. And it is my privilege to introduce our lovely engineer who's had way too many frying pans to the head, Drew.
You know, I'd like to take that personally, but I won't. So, Jacob, have you watched anything this week?
Yeah, actually.
Or over the last 2 weeks, I should say.
Yeah, over the last 2 weeks. Yes, I had a chance to finish the series on Netflix, Mobile Suit Gundam Unicorn.
Mm-hmm.
Which I found as a very incredibly well-done, executed anime, which I fell in love with, loved it. It took a little while to get into it because my first real experience into Gundam was Mobile Suit Gundam Wing.
Right.
Which everybody probably watched when they came on Toonami in the 90s.
Well, not everyone.
Not everybody. But
I will admit that I happened to miss that.
Ah. Well,
it's called Junior High.
Ah. Okay.
Not always making it home for Toonami.
I gotcha. Well, I'm a little bit older than you, so.
You would have been in high school when I was in junior high, which would have been worse.
Yes.
At least it was for me. So.
But anyway, yeah, Gundam Wing was my first intro into the Gundam franchise.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't really know anything about the original Gundam, so stepping into this was sort of a challenge in a way,
mm-hmm.
because you had so much history, because this show takes place in what's called the Universe Central,
mm-hmm.
where the Gundam series originated. So it took me about 4 or 5 episodes to stepping into the shoes of this world to understand, okay, this is going on. Okay, I'm starting to get rhythm of this. And it's like an 8-9 episode series. So I'm flowing along, great series. It has the whole Gundam feel of peace, no war.
Mm-hmm.
And then it gets to the end and it's like, what the fudge is this? The ending was so bizarre.
Are you saying it's Evangelion?
A little bit. A little bit. Well, a friend of mine, because I had I posted on Facebook what I thought about it. Mm-hmm. And he was like, well, be like, this ending proved that, like, so, these so-and-so characters had rights and everything. But the entire big MacGuffin of the entire series was over a removed article from something that was written nearly 100 years ago. So mm-hmm. this entire battle is over a MacGuffin.
That's not even important.
That's pseudo-important. So, yeah, I was slightly disappointed with the end. Yeah. So, yeah, if you're a Gundam fan, yeah, go watch this. If you're not, probably go find some reviews on YouTube to get yourself acclimated to this universe, because mm-hmm. it takes some time to get into it.
Okay. Would I be right in thinking that if you were into it, into Gundam, you probably would have already watched it, most likely, if you knew anything about that particular time frame? Because I know there's like four different universes in Gundam.
Yeah, there's the Universal Century, and then there's the spinoffs.
Okay.
The, you know, like Gundam Wing, Gundam Seed, Gundam 00, all those series.
The one I actually watched, G Gundam.
Yeah, G Gundam, yeah.
Mobile Fighter G Gundam.
Yeah, that was the most bizarre one I've ever
seen. Yeah, but it was fun.
It was fun. It was fun. What have you been watching?
Is that all you've been watching?
No, I mean, like, you're right.
I say, because you told me something last week. On the bad episode, I want to make sure you admitted to.
Yes! Yes, okay. All right.
Well, I'm keeping that in, by the way.
What?
No! We'll see.
It's okay. I'm going to get a timer. Get that out of there!
Sneak that in after you've approved the episode. You'll never know.
Like, Drew, you're fired as an engineer!
Then you can edit for a while.
But yes, there was another series that I did watch. I was off on Monday, and I was like, keep watching, you know, flicking on Netflix like everybody else does. It's like, oh, there's this little My Little Pony show. I was like, I'll give it a shot. Watched the pilot episode. I was like, okay, it was pretty good. I was intrigued to be like, it's definitely for a younger audience, but it was fun to watch.
The interesting thing about that first season, which I'm not explaining that I actually watched the show myself. That first season, they were unaware an adult audience was actually watching.
Yeah.
Like, they were aware that the parents of the children they were aiming towards were watching. So there are a couple more stuff that's aimed more at an adult audience. Not, you know, like, risque or obscene or anything, but just, right. You know. It's after season two where the story actually starts getting good.
Okay.
But keep watching. That's all I'm going to say. Keep watching.
Okay. I'll definitely take that into recommendation.
Okay. Have been watching a little show on Netflix called Troll Hunters.
Ah.
It has been very interesting. It's an action-adventure show. It stars the voice talents of the late Anton Yelchin, who played this Chekhov on the new Star Trek movies.
Oh, yeah.
You got Frasier. What is his name?
Kelsey Grammer,
thank you. I was thinking, it's Frasier. That's the character's name. That's not the actor's name. But it's got a Kelsey Grammer, and I can't remember any other people who are starring in it. But it is a very fun little action-adventure show, and I highly suggest that for kids of all ages.
Good.
And I also got to see a little movie called Dragon Ball Super, Broly.
Really?
Yes. I was unaware it was even still showing until I happened to be looking one night. It's actually a very good movie. It's one of the longer Dragon Ball movies.
Yeah.
At 2 hours.
Oh, okay.
And the first half hour is pretty much canonizing every pre-event that was technically canon, but not really canon. That's hard to get into. But essentially, it was everything before the planet Vegeta got blew up.
Ah.
The second was the actual setup to how, from, you know, the modern day setups, like, okay, here's where we left from the end of Super to this episode. It's that kind of setup. And then the last hour is one long fight scene.
Oh, okay.
One long, epic, awesome, amazing fight scene. Nice. That people who don't like shonen anime probably don't like, but heck, I was having a good time. So I do highly suggest that also. And one thing I have watched since our first try at recording this, I was watching this right before I came over here, actually. It's a little show called Zombieland Saga. It is an anime where this young girl is on her way to school one morning, gets run over by a truck, wakes up 10 years later as a zombie, and is told that she was woken up to save this little town called Saga, and to do so she must become a idol, which is a Japanese music star, essentially.
A pop star.
Pretty much. And that's how it began.
Okay.
I had so much fun in the two episodes I watched. I will definitely be finishing the show. It is only rated TV-14, but I don't know if it's really for kids.
Okay.
It's more for adults who prefer a little bit cleaner comedy.
I got you.
But it is kind of a goofy comedy, so keep bear that in mind.
Okay, so was it subbed or dubbed?
It was subtitled, unfortunately.
Okay.
It was on Crunchyroll's where I watched it.
Okay.
I don't know if a dub exists, but I highly doubt it, considering current ways things are made.
Gotcha.
But that's what I watched.
Okay. So going into news, there's recently been a new trailer drop for the new Mobile Suit Gundam NT Negative. We'll be showing one-time theater events.
I will not be making it, unfortunately.
Yeah, I thought that would be very interesting because we just talked about another, you know, basically the follow-up to this movie. Or, no, that isn't
sequel?
The follow-up. Yeah, sequel. There we go.
So it is in the same universe as Unicorn?
Yes, it's in the same universe because you actually do see the Unicorn.
Oh, well then there you go.
So it is a sequel to it. So apparently everybody's favorite wall crawler has won quite a few awards.
Yes.
In the past couple of weeks.
So apparently Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse won the best animated film at the recent British Academy of Film and Television Arts Award show, or BAFTA. And didn't you say it also won a couple of Annie Awards?
Yes, it did. It actually won 7, actually.
Nice.
7 awards. This is insane for an animated movie, feature, what have you.
Yes.
That's almost uncanny. It's like going back to the 90s with, you know, Disney.
Yes. Speaking of that, if Spider-Man ends up winning the best animated film, it will be the first non-Disney production since 2012's Rango to actually get it, according to the article I read. Although I think they've got to be including Pixar in that figuring.
Yeah, probably.
But still, Disney is still technically winning because Disney owns Marvel, which owns Spider-Man. So.
Yeah, but technically this is Sony.
It's a Sony deal, so.
It's Sony, so it's a partial win for Marvel.
Disney still wins. Let's just get right down to it.
Yeah, if you boil down to Disney.
Disney's got 3 movies into this year, not just 2. So, true. It's just they only own partial rights to the Spider-Man one.
Okay, so another piece of news.
Mm-hmm.
According to Newsarama.com, apparently Netflix and Nickelodeon have made a deal to where they will make a movie based on the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
I hope it's a good quality.
I hope so, too. I've read 2 different varying sources saying, be like, it's not going to be related to Rise of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, which I have not seen an episode of, or it's going to be related to. So we really don't know yet. All we know is that Netflix and Nickelodeon have reached a deal to make a movie on Netflix.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm hoping for the best.
Yes. Aren't we all? We all want a good movie.
Oh, yeah.
That's all the news I think we've got, isn't it?
Yeah, I think so.
So I guess we now should move into our review of Tangled.
Yes, I believe we should.
I could get used to a view like this. Yep, I'm used to it. Guys, I want a castle. Ah, the kingdom. It is beautiful. Clapping, dancing, general merrymaking. Not a care in the world. At least for most folks. See that handsome fellow running for his life? That is me.
They just can't get my nose right.
And that tower? Well, in that tower, there lived a girl who was just waiting for her life to begin. We really hit it off.
How you doing?
Gentleman that I am, I decided to help her.
I'm prepared to offer you a deal.
She could not resist me.
I didn't want to have to do this, but you leave me no choice. Here comes the smolder.
You coming, Blondie?
And before we knew it, we began to uncover some secrets.
I have to know what they are.
I mean, this is serious stuff
that just might turn this kingdom upside down.
Flynn?
Ryder!
Run!
Head down.
Head down.
Arms in.
Arms in.
Knees apart.
Knees apart. Knees apart.
Huh?
Brought you here. Fate, destiny.
A horse.
Gossome, your finest table, please.
Ah! Who's that?
They don't like me.
Who's that?
Let's just assume for the moment that everyone in here doesn't like me.
Flynn!
This is kind of an off day for me. This doesn't normally happen.
Go. Live your dream.
I will.
Your dream stinks. I was talking to her.
Alright. So I think it's time we start getting into her movie and see if we can untangle this mess.
Oh, the puns are rich tonight.
Oh, yes it is.
So yeah, our movie this week is Tangled.
Mm-hmm.
It was the 50th animated feature film by Walt Disney Animation Studios.
Yes.
Which, if you didn't know that before you started the movie, you would know during the production card. Is I think this is the first time they used the Steamboat Willie logo at the beginning
yes,
of the movie.
Yes, it is. It is.
And they, of course, put special with this one with showing that it was the 50th.
Yes. So let's talk about a little bit of the cast and crew of this movie.
Right. So, in the role of Rapunzel, you got Mandy Moore.
Aww.
Okay. you got Zachary Levi as Flynn Rider.
Yeah. Which is going to be... Who's...
Playing Shazam.
Playing Shazam, the new DC movie.
Mm-hmm. Donna Murphy as Mother Gothel.
Uh-huh.
Hellboy as Stabbington Brother. Sorry, that's Ron Perlman.
Yes.
But I'm sorry. I see that name, I go, Hellboy!
Boy, yes!
And the only other couple good big names I'm seeing is Jeffrey Tambor as a thug,
mm-hmm.
Brad Garrett as a thug.
He's hook hand.
Hook hand thug, yes. He's the piano man.
Yeah, he's the piano man.
Play us the song, you're the piano man.
Play us the song, you're the piano man. Okay, moving on. And then, of course, you've got Byron Howard's cameo as a thug, because he was also the director.
Mm-hmm.
And
Nathan Gert. Yeah, that's the director. That's the other director.
Nathan Greeno.
Nathan Greeno is the other director. So let's talk about our directors.
Yes. Let's.
Yeah, so Brian Howard, one of our directors. He's also known as a art director, and actor. I don't know what he's directed in. But for the movies I do know he has directed, he directed Zootopia.
Mm-hmm.
Tangled, obviously.
Yes.
Bolt. Which is an amazing movie. He was the animation director for Big Brother.
Brother Bear?
Brother Bear.
Mm-hmm.
He directed Tangled Ever After, the short, which is an amazing little short. We'll have to get to that at some point.
Yeah. He also wrote a lot of these.
Yes, he did. Oh, he directed Super Rhino. I forgot about that. That is awesome. Super Rhino is it's a short with Bolt. Which is an amazing little short. It's incredible.
Okay.
He was also director for Chicken Little. He was the director on Lilo and Stitch.
Good movie.
Yes.
That's going to be on our list.
He's done a lot. Be like he was in production. He was part of Mulan.
It appears he was very productive in Walt Disney Animation Studios for a long period of time.
Yeah.
I noticed he was on a lot of miscellaneous crews.
Yeah, he was animation director for Chicken Little, Brother Bear, Lilo and Stitch, John Henry, Mulan, Pocahontas, and he's, a plethora of Disney stuff.
Yes. Nathan Greeno directed Tangled Ever After, Tangled, and Super Rhino.
Mm-hmm.
That's all he's directed, but he has been an actor, or at least a voice actor, in Prep and Landing, mm-hmm. Bolt, and Meet the Robinsons. He played Lefty.
Ah, okay. I still need to watch that film.
It was okay. And he was in he's in a lot of, he's not really have that much. A lot of it seems to be, like, most of his writing stuff is also what he directed.
Yeah.
Those are all the same. Yeah. And he's just been helpful with other Disney properties.
Yeah, he was he was part of the art department in Frozen.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he's, both these directors have been very involved in Disney over the years.
Pretty much.
Pretty much, yeah.
Not quite John Lasseter levels.
But no, not John Lasseter. Oh, John Lasseter.
Yeah, we'll not get into that.
Yeah, let's not, you know, step into that big pile of worms.
Yes. Although, I will only say this for John Lasseter. Without him, I don't think Disney would be where it is right this minute.
Oh, I agree.
So, let's move on.
Or Pixar.
Yes, that too.
All right, so apparently it was written by Dan Vogelman, wrote the screenplay based
on the Brothers Grimm's tale of Rapunzel.
Yes. Which, if you anything know about the original...
I did not know the Brothers Grimm's names were Jacob and Wilhelm.
Yeah.
So, you and the guy who screams in all the movies. Yeah, him.
Yeah, so, if you know anything about the Grimm's story fairy tales, they're very dark.
They're like, very dark. So, it's not surprising that Disney lightened this up like they did with Cinderella and... Snow White.
Yeah, it's Snow
what
White.
What else did they do?
Yeah, Snow White. They did Snow White. They did a quite a bit different.
Yeah, but at the same time, some of those Grimm's fairy tales were not even originated by the Brothers Grimm. They actually adapted it from even older stories.
Oh yes.
So there's some really dark stuff in there when you go back far enough.
Oh yeah. So let's get into a little background
into
what Tangled is.
The idea of making a film based on Rapunzel apparently started back as early as 1996.
Wow.
It was pitched to then Disney CEO Michael Eisner,
who
approved it, and they got a script written.
Okay.
They got pretty far along. It was going to be, and eventually it was just decided it wasn't going to fit what they were doing at the moment.
Yeah.
Apparently, according to the guy who was writing it, Glenn Keane, or he was the supervising animator.
Well, technically he was the director at first.
Yes, he was the director. And apparently, from what he said, that original script would have been like Shrek, but with Rapunzel.
Ew.
So it's got kind of comedy, that kind of...
Yeah.
Not really Disney, more like what we think of now as DreamWorks.
Yeah.
But that's how that originally started off.
Yeah, and I think you can still find remnants of that when you go to the end credits. The end credits of the scene where you see all the, like, the... like the monkey and everything.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think that was part of the original script. And so you had...
Well, then you got the little old man dressed as Cupid hanging from the balloons.
Yeah.
I think that comes from that, too.
Yeah, I think so. That's some of that kind of, you know, still...
That particular version of that film was announced in 2003 as Rapunzel Unbraided.
Yeah. Wow.
And it apparently was entirely different from the movie we got.
Okay. Like usual.
Yeah. Because everything always starts off different than how it comes out.
Yeah.
So, it was put on hold for a bit until,
it was in development for a very long time.
It was in what they call development hell.
Yes.
For a bit. Eventually, they, rewrote the script to what we now know, where they tried to, have it be more of based on Rapunzel and the character we now know as Ryder.
Yeah.
Be the main characters.
Yeah.
Be more of an adventure story than a princess story.
Yeah, true. I think it was somewhere around the time that Glenn Keane dropped out due to having a heart attack.
Yes.
And so he eventually came back as the character supervisor.
Mm-hmm. So one of the interesting things I found when I was reading this, reading up on this,
yeah,
was that there was apparently a controversy with the name Tangled.
Okay.
Apparently people thought you shouldn't rename a movie... You shouldn't rename a story about Rapunzel and give it a different name like Tangled, because that would be like calling the Little Mermaid Drowned or something like that.
Yeah.
Honestly, I kind of go with what the director, I can't remember which director it was, that said why they chose the name. I think it's the same director who did Bolt, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was Howard.
Yeah, Byron Howard. He said... You couldn't have called Toy Story Buzz Lightyear and it make any sense.
Yeah.
And I kind of like that idea. To be honest.
Yeah, kind of like you said in our previous scratch recording,
yes.
That it would be like, It'd be like calling Lion King Scar.
I think I brought that one up in Frozen, actually, because I was talking about how it was seemed to be more named after the villain.
I think you're right. I think you're right in that
one. But it's the same deal.
Yeah, it's the same deal.
Naming a movie after a character works sometimes.
Yes.
But in this sense, I think this fits more. The thing people were complaining about more with changing the name, or the reason they changed the name,
yeah,
I should say, was because their previous movie to this, The Princess and the Frog, it did not do as well in theaters.
Yeah.
And there was some belief or some theory going around that a part of the reason that was because of the word princess in the title drove the boys away from wanting to watch the movie because it was a princess movie. And they wanted to get more, they wanted to choose a more gender-neutral name in order to get the guys to want to come see the show too.
Right.
That's why the trailers, when you watch them, are just as much promoting Flynn Rider's character as they are Rapunzel's.
Yes, I completely concur.
So, I guess we should talk about Rapunzel then, at least.
Yeah. You know, give a little more detail into the movie that, yes, it was finally released on November 24, 2010.
Mm-hmm. How did you first see this movie?
Oh, I was part of a college group in the church we attend,
mm-hmm.
that one of the members who was having a birthday, and she was, you know, blonde hair and a whole bit, and her mother was like, oh, this sounds like, sounds like a perfect idea. Let's go watch Tangled.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, someone who had not seen I think the last Disney film I had watched at that point was probably Bolt, which is kind of ironic.
Yes.
Kind of ironic with the same director. And so I go in and watch this movie, you know, with these two other people. I am blown away. It's like, oh my gosh. They're like, this is beautiful. Absolutely gorgeous. Great story. Amazing. And to be frank, it's probably one of my favorite Disney films.
I concur with that. The first time I saw it, I'll admit, when it was in theaters, I was in that weird belief that I wasn't going to go watch a Disney movie.
Right.
So I missed pretty much, I think the last Disney movie I saw before this was Meet the Robinsons.
Oh.
And ironically, I came back into watching Disney with Frozen, which is a weird choice for me, to be honest. But I didn't see this until a couple years later.
Yeah.
When I was on Netflix looking for something to watch after a long day at work, and Tangled was on there due to it being on there because of Stars.
Yeah.
Remember when a lot of Disney stuff was on Netflix because of Stars Network.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So that was the first time I watched it, was at like 11 o'clock at night in my own room in the middle of the night.
Yeah.
Watching it through Netflix. And I remember going, I love this movie. I don't know how I missed this. I'm going to have to go watch more Disney movies. And then I didn't. But I did see Frozen technically before this. So.
Oh, okay.
And I'd been told many times that Tangled was the better movie of the two. Which I agree with now looking back on it, but I was a little iffy because, well, not all the movies in the era preceding it were doing as good.
Oh, yeah. Completely agree.
So, that's how I got into it.
Okay. So, let's talk about the movie a little bit.
Yes. I'm convinced Rapunzel's hair is prehensile.
Prehensile.
Well, here's the thing. The hair itself is all over the place.
Yeah.
There's never has its own length. In fact, one of the things I read was they intentionally never specified how long the hair was supposed to be. It would grow and shrink depending on what was needed for the scene.
Yeah, because technically it was 70 feet, but
let's face it, I don't care how well you braid somebody's hair. You're not going to get 70 feet of hair to braid down to 6 foot.
Yeah, and the stuff she was able to do with
and said she's hair, not even 6 foot tall.
No, she's not.
But still.
Either she has a very strong scalp, or she is.
Oh, she's got strong roots. That's the only way that works.
Exactly. She's strong roots.
And that still has to hurt.
She has
The two people we mainly see besides her get used by the hair. Used by the hair. That's a horrible way to put that. But that deal with the hair.
Yeah. Long, that's beautiful hair.
Yeah. are her and Mother Gothel and Flynn.
Yes.
Of the three, I think technically Flynn is the heaviest. That's still got to be killer on her hair.
Yeah.
And that's a good, 150 pounds.
And the thing, she had, when Mother Gothel first shows up, you know, like when she's 18 years old, is like, you know, Rapunzel, let down your hair. And she pulls her up and be like, how do you do this every day? It must be exhausting. She's been doing this for years.
Yeah.
So she has
got definitely some muscles or calluses or something up under there.
Yeah.
And somehow none of that hair has come out.
Yeah.
In 18 years. Except for the one that was cut when she was a baby, of course.
Yeah.
How does that work?
Titanium roots?
Must be. I mean, that sunlight that causes her hair to glow must make those roots really strong. Talk about some serious vitamin D. So, what I meant earlier by her having prehensile hair is in that very first scene where we see her using her hair to catch Pascal.
Yes.
There's no way she was able to grab Pascal with her hair without actually using her hand to do it unless she could move the end of her hair.
Yeah.
Which we don't see throughout the rest of the film, but at the same time, it's like, that was just the first thing. It's like, oh, she's got magic hair, so magic that she can move it without touching it.
Yeah.
Except she never does that ever again.
Well, she does, because there's so many points where, like, she'll toss it over, like, toss it over this. You can't do that with hair.
Well, you don't know what the properties of hair that long are.
That's true.
That you can bundle up and then somehow throw over a limb and then use it as a claw shot. To use a Zelda term, claw shot.
Grapple.
Yes, a grapple. Grappling hook. Why could I not think of the word grappling hook? I'm a fan of Gravity Falls and I can't think of the word grappling hook.
Which is a show I need to watch.
Yes, and you will eventually, one way or another.
You will watch this show.
So, I guess we should actually talk about Rapunzel herself.
Yeah, let's
talk about her character.
Yeah. So with Rapunzel herself, the first thing that brought attention to me is that she's an artist.
Yes.
She's an artist. Be like, you go into her tower, which is the only place she's ever known for 18 years.
Yes.
Is covered wall to ceiling, floor to ceiling with art all over the place.
Mm-hmm. You're like, very good at it.
She's very good at it.
I mean, where, kind of hard to say that knowing that a professional artist actually drew the stuff, but
yeah. But the fact that I think if we were to, you know, say if we were Rapunzel's shoes, I guarantee we would get the worst tongue lashing in our planet, the world, if we decide to draw on the walls.
Well, I think to some degree in this instance,
yes.
That was one of the few freedoms Mother Gothel gave
her. Yeah, I agree.
I think to some degree she realized Rapunzel needed something to keep her entertained in the long periods that she was being left alone in that tower.
Yes.
What I find interesting is that there was never at any point, or at least there's no evidence of any point, of her having to repaint over her artwork to get more canvas. Because that last thing where she paints the lanterns?
Yeah.
That appears to be the last empty spot on the wall.
Yeah.
In the entire tower. The only thing she hasn't really done is the floor. And I think there's stuff on the floor besides what Mother Gothel draws down there.
Yeah. Yeah, it's the first thing that came to mind is, like, how abundantly is she like an artist.
Mm-hmm. What I find interesting, at least when I noticed, is that the entire time she seems to embody the nature of what we think of as a princess.
Yeah.
Especially of a Disney princess.
Yes.
Despite the fact she doesn't know she is one.
Yeah.
She's able to get pretty much everyone on her side, including the most dirty, evil people who walk the planet.
Yeah.
To be her friends.
Yeah.
And to allow her to escape when she's going to get captured by Captain of the Guard, which, if she, that would have made that movie go a lot faster.
Yeah.
If she'd have got caught there. But then Flynn would not have had the scene he needed.
Yeah.
But.
And she has an animal companion.
Yes, Pascal. She can apparently talk to animals.
Yes.
Although besides Pascal, the only other one we actually see her talk to is Maximus. And it's very obvious Maximus is an intelligent animal.
Yeah.
Because I think Flynn pretty much communicates with him also.
Yeah, he's more of a sentient
horse. He's a sentient horse.
Yes.
I almost said sentient mare. That would not have worked because he's not a mare. He's a stallion. Yeah.
I'm offended by that.
And what... Okay, Sven. But the interesting thing is, bringing it back to her being an artist.
Yeah.
She apparently does at least have some memories of the very short time she was in the palace.
Yes.
Because somehow in all her artwork, she painted the little symbol of the Kingdom of Corona.
Yes.
Everywhere, to the point where when she finally puts two and two together.
Yeah, that realization.
Yeah, in that scene, she realizes she's the lost princess. Yes. And immediately she goes from being the happy-go-lucky princess we've seen the entire movie.
Yeah.
To actually holding herself like a princess.
Yeah.
She actually goes from the Cinderella-type princess to the Princess Aurora-type princess in one scene. And yes, you can see her change
Yeah, you watch her progression from that. Yeah, like you said. Yeah. It's fantastic because there's those two scenes in that film where the animators, when it comes to Rapunzel, just did it just fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
Where you have the one scene where Mother Gothel returns to the tower and they go into the lights again and be like, I hope we're not going to get into this again. In the scene where Mother Gothel proclaims that you are never leaving this tower ever.
Mm-hmm.
In that one instant where it's Rapunzel reacts,
mm-hmm,
it's all facial movements and everything. It's not vocal or anything, but it's more that Rapunzel, she's in shock. It's, oh my gosh, they're like,
this is what this is.
This is what this is.
Not what I thought we were doing.
Yeah.
This is what's actually happening.
Yes. And so she looks at the cupboard, knowing that Flynn's there.
Just stuffed him in there.
Yeah, we should just stuffed him in there. We'll get back to how terrible shape Flynn Rider should be in.
Yes.
And then she looks up to their painting of the floating lights, the lanterns, and then looks back, looks down at the, and then she kind of composes herself.
Mm-hmm.
And then she makes the excuse and be like, oh, I know what I want for my birthday now, which to get Mother Gothel out of the house.
For three days. Is the idea.
That is the idea.
Yes. It's not a bad idea.
No, it's not a bad idea at all.
The problem is, it doesn't work that way.
No. Thanks, Maximus.
Somehow this all ends up being his fault. We talked last movie about how the entire movie was Anna's fault.
Anna,
whatever. You know that's going to be a meme in this show. Yes. Of me saying Anna's name wrong.
Yeah, Anna.
Anna. But this movie is completely Maximus's fault. And he's admittedly not the one who caused the queen to get sick.
Yeah.
He's not the one that caused Rapunzel to get kidnapped. But every other problem is his.
Yeah.
It's his fault. Because he's just trying to be a good...
A soldier. He's trying to be a good soldier's horse.
Yes. But,
which leads to him and Ryder falling off the cliff.
Yes.
Which leads Ryder to, you know, getting into finding the tower.
So, yeah, let's talk about Maximus.
Yeah, let's talk.
We kind of transition to that. I love how they humanized the character.
Yeah.
I think my favorite scene is in his introduction scene,
mm-hmm,
where you got the captain and his two officers are on top of their horses, and captain gives out his orders to the other two soldiers. The camera shifts down. Maximus does the exact same thing. It's like, oh, these are the guys we're following, not the people on the horse.
Yeah, we're following the horses.
And they are just as much worried about getting this guy also. So, and then Maximus ends up chasing Flynn.
Yeah, all over the place.
Mm-hmm. Especially to right before Flynn gets to the cave.
Hilarity pursues.
Yes, and they're on that tree, and he's trying to get him and stomping on his leg. And then, of course, you're watching, going, "That tree is rotting. How is it holding you up now? Much less, how is it going to continue holding up when you've got a? I don't know how heavy a horse is in terms of weight.
Yeah,
but it's not light.
Oh yeah,
and you're stomping on the tree. How much longer? How worth it is this guy? I know you're trying to get the crown back, But you can pick him up. You can pick it up after when you find his body down at the bottom of the cliff. You could wait a minute.
Yeah, and how durable are these characters? They both plummet, and they...
This movie is a bit more cartoony.
Yeah, oh yeah, I agree.
Than realistic.
Yes, oh, I agree.
Which I like.
Yes. It just makes it even funnier.
Yes.
They go tumbling down the cliff, and he literally... Maximus is a horse dog.
Pretty much. He sniffs like a bloodhound.
Uh-huh.
When he's petted behind the ears, you see his little tail do that little wagging thing, just like a dog's.
Uh-huh.
And he likes apples. Although, I don't know if... Dogs like apples.
Dogs like treats.
Whatever. It's a treat. That's all it is. That's what the apple is. So yeah, he's very much a dog in horse's clothing.
Yes. He's a good boy.
Yes.
So
who can apparently move people out of his way with his hose just like that.
Yes. So speaking of animals, why don't we talk about Pascal?
Ah, yes. The best friend a young girl can have when she's stuck in a tower.
Yes.
He might be my favorite of the Disney princess... animal sidekicks.
Yeah.
Especially the scene when, after she's got Flynn Rider tied to the chair, and Pascal is on the edge of a frying pan that she's holding out towards him, trying to hold him at bay like the frying pan's a gun. And Pascal's looking at him, he's staring deep into his eyes. He looks back at Rapunzel, does that little, move, so she knows to move it back. And he turns back and does the little... points at his eyes, points at Flynn, back, forth. As she slowly moves.
And he growls.
He's like, okay, I guess I love this.
Mm-hmm.
And we talked about on last time how he doesn't use his chameleon powers that much.
No.
In terms of hiding, he only uses it in that way one time, which is at the very beginning of the movie. But the rest of the time, he only does it for emotions, it seems.
Yeah, well, there's obviously the one where he blends in with the flower pot.
Yeah.
And the one where he blends in with the...
He does blend in with the lantern painting.
Yes, he does.
Near the beginning.
Yeah, that's about the only time he actually uses his quote-unquote chameleon powers.
For camouflage. The rest of the time he is showing emotion with.
Emotion or being funny.
Right.
Yeah, definitely...
He is one of the more fun ones we've had.
Yes, he is. Anyways.
So from there, since we have talked about Flynn Rider, let's talk about the man who should be dead.
Yes!
Long before he actually gets stabbed.
Yeah, way too many frying pans to the head.
Yes. How he is still walking after the scene where she stuffs him into the cabinet.
Yes. At the beginning. Oh, good night. Like,
how are you still living? Especially after your smolder is broken.
Let's see. His hand should be broken. He should have so many concussions. He's probably lying in a hospital bed drooling into a pan.
He's a vegetable at this point. Yeah, or at least he should be.
Yeah, but he's still walking and talking and...
trying to be suave and debonair and failing miserably.
Like, yeah, exactly.
He is the biggest dork.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
I think we've seen in any Disney movie. Although I'm sure I'm not thinking of something.
Yeah, he's very much the...
He's the biggest leading man dork.
Yeah, I agree. And also, he's more of a reverse prince.
Yes.
Because he's a thief, and he's not a prince. So...
Not till he marries Rapunzel at the end of the movie.
Technically, they don't get married at the very end of the movie.
He does say they got married.
Okay, never mind.
Last thing says... specifically says... someone asks someone to marry them... And I finally said yes.
Eugene.
So technically...
Yes.
He was married by the end of the movie, as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah.
Right before Anna and Elsa's parents got killed in a boat crash. I'm still claiming that's what happened.
Yeah.
But, and then, of course, they would go on to do their cameo in Frozen. He is one of the most fun characters I think I've seen in a while.
Yeah.
I love there at the very beginning when he's stealing the crown and he reenacts the scene from Mission Impossible.
Oh, yes.
And he almost gets away with it.
He almost.
Till the guard sneezes and he says, allergies? Hay fever. Not say hay fever. I don't remember which.
Hay fever.
But it's the same difference.
Yeah.
He's like, oh, yeah. Hey, what?
Wait.
And he's... up there, like, of course, now he's being chased all over the countryside by the world's greatest bloodhound horse. Blood horse? No, blood horse doesn't sound good.
No, blood horse doesn't sound good.
He's a character that's like, I want, especially the end, when you feel bad that he's been caught through Mother Gothel's machinations.
Mm-hmm.
He's almost forced to betray Rapunzel, you kind of want to kick him in the butt for not, for going to that part of the shore. He should have known not to go there. They should have gone back to the other shore, in the castle.
Yeah, he should have stayed with Rapunzel, because
I know there's a reason the entire movie takes forever and a day for her to realize who she is.
Yeah.
How quickly did Flynn catch on, is my question.
Yeah.
It doesn't show. It just seems like, oh, I've got to go save Rapunzel. She's the princess. He's got to have seen the
writing on the wall.
The whole thing where, with the mural. He's got to have seen that mural and thought, blonde hair, blue eyes, been missing for 18 years, and her birthday's the same day the princess's birthday was, and when they put the lanterns out in the sky. How many more numbers do you need to put together to come up with this answer?
Well, I think in Ryder's defense, he was a little too smitten by Rapunzel at that point to even care about this.
Maybe so. I mean, at the beginning, he's just trying to get rid of her so he can get his satchel back and go on about his business.
Yeah.
And you're right. By the end, I think he's already given up on his dream and is wanting to be with Rapunzel.
Yeah.
And he doesn't know what that means for her. The minute he tells her his real name.
Yeah.
Is Eugene Fitzherbert.
Mm-hmm.
Such a horrible little name.
Yeah.
But all that leaves is Mother Gothel.
In terms of
characters. The most evil Disney villain I think there is.
Yes, she is.
I think I might say this every week. Or at least I have so far. I mean, she's the only one that admits that she's the bad guy in the course of the movie. She says it twice.
Yeah. Yeah. Now I'm the bad guy.
And I'll say yes, she is the bad guy because she's, and the reason I say she's the most evil is because she raised Rapunzel.
Yeah.
She is her mother and for all intents and purposes.
Yes.
And she used every single one of Rapunzel's weaknesses against her to get her way.
Yeah. And basically used Rapunzel as a tool.
Yes.
For her own gain.
But I have a couple problems with Mother Gothel's plan as a villain. First off, we notice she's not a witch, even though I kind of thought until this last viewing she was, because in my mind, the whole song that she had to sing was a spell.
Yeah.
But she's not. She's just an old woman, essentially.
A very old woman.
Who somehow was able to come across a flower that grew from a drop of sunlight.
Yes.
That, and she immediately recognized that, oh, I can use this to heal and to keep myself young. Well, her first mistake is hiding this flower under a basket that can be easily turned over.
Yes.
Okay, first of all, you've got a tower. Admittedly, we don't know when the tower was built. We don't know if she found that tower after she kidnapped Rapunzel or not. But obviously, she's got to have a place to live. Probably it is the tower, I'm guessing.
Yeah.
Transplant the flower.
Yeah.
Because nobody was able to find that tower until Ryder happened upon it 18 years later.
And the flower was set on a cliffside
that could be seen from the
everywhere.
Castle. And you're going to cover it with a basket? I mean,
it was a good idea until she knocked it over and forgot to put it back.
Yeah. I mean, it does sound like she didn't learn the lesson from the old the old nursery rhyme, "This Little Light of Mine, I'm going to let it shine. I'm not going to hide it under a basket." I don't remember the whole thing, but that's what went through my mind.
Yeah.
So that's problem one. Problem two, she's smart enough to know that the guards found the flower. She knows what kingdom found where the guards belong to, because we don't really know how many other kingdoms are in that little area.
Yeah.
She follows them there. They make up the potion, sees that the mother drinks it. There's time for the baby to be born and to get to a point where she's not ugly looking, as babies do seem to be doing in their early years. And she doesn't know that if she cuts the baby's hair, that it will destroy the magic in that part of the hair. What was she going to do? Come back to the castle every day for years?
Yeah, I don't think she's going to be invited back.
And also, how on earth did she not wake up Rapunzel's parents that were asleep in the same room when she started singing that song?
Yeah. I guess it was more like Rapunzel's cry woke them?
Yeah, but
they were sound sleepers until they heard the child cry.
Which, admittedly, that would wake them up. And perhaps Mother Gothel was singing very softly, but no, I'm sorry. That would have, your baby's in the room, you probably just got her to sleep, you're not asleep yet.
Yeah, and you hear
and
this.
And you also say, flower glooming, or whatever.
Gleaming glow. Gleam glow.
Why did I say gloom? It's like, somebody's singing. There's no radios in this time period. We are at least a mile above the city in terms of height.
It's like, wait.
There should be no sound up here, and they're singing. Who's stealing the baby? Get her! Show check that! That would be my thought. But that's not what happens.
Yeah.
And then, you do have the other problem. So she kidnaps Rapunzel to hide her away in this tower, and you can tell her plan at this point is to keep Rapunzel safe enough that she can continue to use this magic.
Yeah, to use her hair.
What's going to happen when Rapunzel gets old and dies of old age?
That's a very good question. My original thought was that she would kidnap some guy, get Rapunzel pregnant, and produce a child, right. But
there's a problem with that.
Yeah.
The fact is, if she kidnaps a guy old enough for Rapunzel to have relations with, that person's going to be telling her of the outside world, which is going to get her out of there. It's going to plant an idea in her mind to leave there.
Yeah.
So, that doesn't work. And plus, how do you know that the magic hair thing is a hereditary trait?
Yeah.
You don't know. You have no proof of that.
Yeah, because be like...
Because it can be easily... The magic can easily go away by the cutting of the hair.
Yeah.
Now, obviously, she's got some residual power right after all her hair is cut at the end, because she's able to fully heal Ryder.
Yeah.
But that's kind of like the last of it. I mean, she, at best, Mother Gothel's got maybe 80 years left before Rapunzel's going to die of old age. At some point, Rapunzel's going to put two and two together and realize,
if the events of the story
I'm older looking than my mother. How is this? And then, can Rapunzel use that power on herself? That's not actually shown. I'm curious of that part. It kind of makes sense she could.
Yeah.
It's not shown. But anyway, that's the problem I have with her plan, is it's only going to buy Mother Gothel at most 80 years.
Yeah. And kind of going into the fact of how Mother Gothel dies. When the hair is cut, she instantly
dies.
Yeah, like, she doesn't instantly die.
You're correct. She grows old very quickly.
Yeah, she rapidly
ages. Disintegrates.
One of my thoughts was, like, every time that scene comes up, you always see Pascal be like, as Mother Gothel is, like, just writhing, mm-hmm. be like, you see Pascal look up and he grabs the hair, the
last of the hair.
Last of the hair, pulls it tight, and she goes tumbling off of it into the...
Yeah, it's that scene where the villain gets their just dessert. I do want to talk about in terms of animation.
Okay,
now that we've gone through all the characters.
Okay,
I absolutely love the lantern scene.
Absolutely,
it is so beautiful watching those lanterns come over.
Oh yeah, I completely agree with that. Mm-hmm. I think it was a point you brought up last time with how during the lantern scene and Flynn Rider.
Yeah,
the point where. I see the light. There we go. It's where Rapunzel she scoops up the lantern and tosses it back up on the lake.
Which, ironically, is the lantern the king and queen let loose.
Yeah, it's her lantern. It's
her lantern, and it came to her.
Ironic? I don't think so.
No, I'm sure that's not symbolic in the slightest. I also love most of the lighting in this movie. The sunset is one of the most beautiful Disney movies I think we've seen in a while.
Yeah.
I know when we talked on the robot episode on this movie, the robot version, you had a problem with the skin tones in the Snuggly Duckling.
Yes.
I don't have a problem with it, and here's why.
Okay.
Throughout the rest of the movie, with the exception of... the scene at the end where they're in at the top of the tower. The rest of this movie is very bright.
Yes.
And very cheerful.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of light
mm-hmm.
everywhere. In the Snuggly Dunkling, it is intentionally designed to look dark, sinister, And, like, this is not the spot you want to be found on a dark night.
Understood.
So because there's so little light in there, there's not a lot of light to reflect off of things. And so that's why a lot of the skin tones don't look exactly right.
Okay.
Because you'll know when those characters show back up elsewhere in the movie, in the more cheerful scenes, they do look better.
Yeah. Oh, I agree. Yeah, the animation in this film is top-notch.
Mm-hmm.
Top-notch. Some might say, well, it's older. Well, it was 2010.
For 2010 animation, it looks great.
Yeah.
And that 2010 was really not that bad in terms of 3D animation.
No, it wasn't.
In fact, we have not seen that much, at least from what I can see, that much visual change in the pre-rendered movies since Monsters University.
Yeah.
Not been that much visual change. There's stuff that looks better, cause, especially when we talked about Spider-Verse earlier. But that's intentionally using a different art style.
Yeah. Yeah, because when you wind up talking with a bunch of people about animation that maybe doesn't really appreciate animation, mm-hmm. you find that a lot of people will say, well, the older animation isn't that good. They're like, hand-drawn animation isn't that good. It's not as good as 3D rendered.
When we get to our first 2D movie, we actually talk about Cell Animation, which our podcast is named after.
Uh-huh.
We'll definitely be able to go over this a little bit more.
Yes.
But I will say the one advantage that 3D animation has over 2D is the fact that once you have the scene block, you can shoot it from any angle you desire. If the first angle you come up with doesn't work,
mm-hmm.
all you got to do is in the software, move the camera over.
Yes.
And you've got better, you got more dynamic lighting. You don't have to, especially nowadays.
Mm-hmm.
And you can do some stuff that looks better. That's not saying that the Cell animation is worse.
Yeah.
It's different.
Yes, I agree. Yeah, you can't per se the past just because everything looks bright and shiny now.
Right. And my thought has always been, yes, we have new stuff.
Mm.
Use the new stuff while we have it, because eventually it's not going to be new anymore. Something will come along and surpass it.
Mm.
It's just a different style. You gotta roll with it. I can't love 3D and hate 2D
mm-hmm.
for the same reason I can't love 2D and hate claymation, or love those and hate stop motion. It's just different. It doesn't make it necessarily better or worse. May not be your cup of tea.
Yeah.
But that's subjective, not objective.
Yeah, agree.
Anyway. Well, we've reached the end of another episode, so that means it's time to pick our next movie to review. So, to remind everyone about where our what movies are where on the dice.
Yes.
Number one is Anastasia, which is yours.
Yes.
Number two, Batman: Return of the Caped Crusaders, which is mine.
Hmm.
Sitting at number three, Transformers the Movie.
Yes.
Which is yours.
Yes.
Number four, The Lego Movie. Which was mine. Number five, How to Train Your Dragon.
Yes.
And number six, The Girl Who Leapt Through Time. So,
let's roll those beautiful dice.
Roll the dice. And it's the Lego Movie!
Yes! I can't wait to watch this movie.
Yes, indeed. I did actually just come from watching the sequel, so will eventually be on our review list, but we gotta go through the first one first.
Excellent.
So,
I can't wait to review it.
Yes. So, you want to tell everyone where they can find us online?
All right, excellent. So, if you're interested in finding us where we're at, we can currently be found. You can find us on our Facebook page, The Cellcast.
Well, it's a Facebook group, actually.
Well, Facebook group. Whichever.
Well, there is a difference.
Yeah,
sure. But yeah, it is a closed group, so all y'all got to do is just ask to join, and we'll make sure you're not a robot, and then we'll let you in.
Yeah.
Unlike at the beginning of this, where we were robots.
Yes, exactly.
And you can also email us at thecellcastpodcast@gmail.com.
And so those who are wondering where you can find us in podcast land, just go to your favorite podcast directory. Please rate and review us there. 5 stars would be much appreciated.
We won't turn it down.
No, of course not.
And of course you can find me, if you're looking for me on Facebook, I'm under Drew Dodgen. I have nothing else there at the moment. I'm still working on my maybe other project, but we'll see.
And you can find me at Jacob B. Heron on Facebook. And also you can also find me on Facebook at Jacob's Daily Art Corner, where I try to
quote unquote, try to draw each and every day.
Well, I can't speak for your for how often, but when you do draw, it is pretty good.
Well, thank you.
And that's it for us. I'm Drew.
This is Jacob.
And we'll see you in the next frame.
I'll get you next time.
Legs, legs, gang, let's get out of here. Rah, let's get out of here. Rye.
Flower, gleam and glow. Let your power shine. Make the clock reverse. Bring back what once was mine. Heal what has been hurt. Change the fate's design. Save what has been lost. Bring back what once was mine. What once was mine.
Next time on
The Cellcast.
Hello, I'm Emmett. I'm just going to come right out. I have no idea what's going on at all.
My fellow master builders, including, but not limited to, Superman, Wonder Woman, the Mermaid, Green Ninja, 1980-something Space Guy,
hello,
Michelangelo, and the 2002 NBA All-Stars, we have learned that Lord Business plans to end the world as we know it. There is yet one hope. The special has arisen.
I think I got it, but just in case, tell me the whole thing again. I wasn't listening.
Everybody, I'm here.
Batman? Awesome! Could you make one of these in orange?
I only work in black, and sometimes very, very dark gray.
Hey, pal, I hate to tell you this, but I don't think you're supposed to be here.
Well, I guess I'm gonna have to report you.
No, wait up!